Now coming about to the maintenance of a soldier, consistency, and you know, how do we give him technology? Well, we've always believed that it is the man behind the weapon that matters. And therefore, empowerment of the soldier is most important. Now, what do we mean by empowerment of the soldier? When we talk of empowering a soldier, it is giving him the kind of systems that he has to, that are required by him to ensure that he is able to imbibe technology and then ensure the surveillance, and so that, you know, I would say the sensor shooter systems get integrated, not just at the highest level, but even at the soldier's level. And then he's imparting him training to ensure that he can utilize that equipment. Now we have to look at the terrain and the conditions under which we operate. We operate under different conditions. We've got deserts, we've got built up areas where, you know, with what we can see the terrain in the Punjab, we've got jungles in JNK and in the northeast, and then of course we've got very high altitude barren terrain. Each of these terrains requires different kinds of the weapon systems, the different kinds of technology for reconnaissance and surveillance. So our basic issue is to give him those. Now what we are trying to do is, for a soldier, as of now we are ensuring that he must have the capability to operate both by day and night. So he's been given devices which will help him to carry out surveillance, reconnaissance both by day and night, so that he can see the terrain in front of him at all times. Then of course is the weapon system. You have to then give him a weapon system with which he can engage what he sees. For that, as far as the soldier on the ground is concerned, we are identifying an assault rifle. The assault rifle, which is the primary weapon for an infantry soldier deployed on the front line, has got delayed because we have changed the GSQR. There was a time when we were looking at a changeable barrel rifle, which on second thought we felt was not the best system we had opted for. So we've changed track. We changed the GSQR, and now we are going for an assault rifle with a range of 500 meters with night firing capability, which means it must have a night sight. So that is what is going to happen. Now, the entire army cannot be equipped with the same assault rifle because this is a very high technology rifle. So what we have decided is, the infantry soldier deployed on the borders, who's got to engage the adversary first along the line of control or anywhere else, he has to be given the assault rifle. So we therefore now separated our requirements. We said the high-tech assault rifle will come in for the soldier, that is the infantry, deployed in the front. Now within the infantry battalion also, everybody does not require this assault rifle. If the infantry has got 750 jawans who need the rifle, we've come to the conclusion that only about 400 to 450 are the actual frontline soldiers. That is the, you can say, the companies that are there in the battalion who are deployed in front. There are some people who are holding heavier weapons. There is somebody who's got an ATGM, somebody's got a mortar, somebody's actually driving a vehicle. Those people may not require these kind of weapons. So within this also we've identified, this is to make sure that we utilize the resources and the funds that are available to us in the most judicious manner. So we are getting a good assault rifle, which is now moving on a fast track procedure. We have identified the rifles which have to come in. The trials are on, and we will very soon be getting this, preferably through a G2G if we can help it, so that we get it faster. So this is what the infantry soldier will get as a rifle. For the other arms and services who need not be equipped with this kind of an assault rifle, we are looking at indigenous solutions, which part of it will be manufactured by the ordnance factories and part by the industry. Our requirements, our numbers are huge. You know, when you say you need 9 to 10 lakh rifles, they can't be manufactured overnight. But if you want to get them in an earlier time frame, let us say in the next 2-3 years you want these rifles to come in, then you've got to look at sophisticated weapons for the infantry, which we need, which we do not have the capacities to make in our country, or we don't have the capability to make that kind of a rifle, we import it. For the others, we go to the ordnance factory, they manufacture it for us, and part we download onto the industry. Why are we now doing this splitting between the ordnance factory and the industry? It is to create competition for the ordnance factory. Today, if the ordnance factory does not come out with a good weapon, and you find that your own indigenous industry comes out with a better weapon, then you cancel those orders and you go that way. So this is to make sure that they also become accountable. They also start improving the standard because they know now there is competition. And with this Make in India initiative that has started, we feel this is the right way to go. Imbibing technology, of course, we are making sure that whatever the soldier gets, he should be capable of utilizing that technology. So, you know, if you look at a soldier who's sitting in the high altitude bunker on the northern borders, how can he use that technology? He must have that technology. He must be able to see what is happening in front of us. So for that, we are going in for UAVs. We are going to have UAVs coming in, which are going to be infantry battalion UAVs. These are these smaller UAVs, which an infantry battalion commander with this reconnaissance or a surveillance machine available to him, he can utilize it to keep his area, you know, the 5 to 10 kilometers, 15 kilometers in front of him, which he must be able to observe through a UAV, which is available to that battalion commander. Now, this is how we are saying that the empowerment of the soldier will take place, is to give him some technologies. He does not have to every time look back for information. Today, the UAV we have, you know, the UAV flies the mission, it lands in a base, then the information has to be fed back to him from the rear. Whereas if you give him these kind of technologies which he can use in the front line, and the commanding officer and the brigade commanders themselves can get the information that they desire, rather than demanding information from the rear or asking for satellite imagery every time, it is better to give him that kind of equipment with technology. That is what we mean by imbibing technology, ensuring that the soldier gets maintained. And of course, the other thing about maintenance is the turnover. You know, we are operating in difficult terrain. We constantly turn over a soldier. So if he's in a difficult, operating in a very difficult area, he serves there for 2 years. He comes to a peace station in a relatively easy area. He serves a 3-year tenure. So we keep rotating him in this kind of a manner. But that notwithstanding, let me tell you, a very large number of our soldiers are still spending a large amount of the time in difficult areas. It is so happening that almost 2 tenures he does in a difficult area and 1 tenure in an easy area. Our idea is to ensure that he can alternate his tenures. But then that notwithstanding, even if he cannot look after that, we are ensuring that his family can be looked after. And for the family, we are going in for merit accommodation project coming up in large numbers. We've got the MAP 1 and MAP 2. MAP 2 is 85% complete. It's only about 15% more that the houses have to come up. Then we've got the MAP 3, which is coming up, where almost 70,000 houses have to be constructed. In the MAP 3, on the immediate priority, we've asked the government to give us some sanction, which they've given us sanction for 4,000 houses, where the jawans can, the families of the jawans can stay, the men can stay. These 4,000 we are actually giving to the desert sector, because what happened was, we did carry out some movement of our troops on the western front, where we moved some forces forward as part of our overall concept and doctrine. When we moved these people forward, we didn't create accommodation for these people. So our priority is that these people who are moved forward, they get the accommodation. That is all that is being done to ensure that he gets empowered and he can be cared for and looked after. Coming on to the PVC awardees and workshop, yes, we do have these PVC awardees. These PVC awardees actually are being taken from time to time to various institutes, not only within the army but even outside the army, where they give out their real life stories as to what is it that led them to become such soldiers. I mean, they have displayed bravery of an exceptional order. So we are doing this. We've also got now PVC, all the PVC awardees, their photographs and their write-ups of what action they had done have been prepared and are now being distributed in colleges and universities around the country. So we've started this process. Almost 180 colleges and universities have been given these posters and the write-ups, and gradually we'll keep building it up, so you will find